whatever we do is worth nothing. I speak to you in the name of one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Every family has their vice. Growing up for the Vigianos, it was McDonald's. We rarely ate at the fast food chain. But when we did, for my parents, it was like manna in the wilderness, and heavenly for the children. Only such an occasion arose on long drives, when the family's communal blood sugar hit empty, tensions were running high, and something needed to be done fast. My father tired of driving, my mother unamused, and all the children still quarreling. Out of nowhere, a sign for the golden arches would appear. Then my mother would announce, "McDonald's, 5 miles." Silence immediately filled the car. The children knew that only good behavior earned the blessed Happy Meal. Otherwise, we were subject to sharing no fun chicken nuggets and fries. Well, after what seemed like the longest 5 miles of my life, we'd exit and pull directly into the drive-thru. What then seemed like only a second, children had to have their orders memorized. My mother would summon our orders in birth order. Elise Kara Sam, order. My response? Happy Meal. Burger with mustard, onion, and pickles, fries, and a Dr. Pepper. My siblings' orders chimed in after mine. Happy Meals also. While proceeding to the next window, we would strain our necks to catch a glimpse of the manna passing through the window into the car. And my mother would distribute the orders accordingly. And just like that, we were back on the road. The orders were usually perfect, except one time it wasn't. Already on the highway, I opened my Happy Meal and excited to pull out the toy that comes with every Happy Meal, only to discover just a burger, fries, and a drink. No surprise toy. Imagine the shock. Imagine the confusion. Imagine the horror. Shock, confusion, horror. Similar feelings to what we witness in today's gospel. For the past 3 weeks, the gospel reading has centered around either Jesus performing miracles with food or Jesus using the metaphor that he is the bread of life. And this week is really no different, and yet oh so different. It's as if the bread of life metaphor is no longer doing justice to what Jesus is trying to convey. So today we hear Jesus lay out literally what he means by the bread of life. He says, "I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh." The bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. The listeners respond, confused. "How can this man give us flesh to eat?" Jesus replies more explicitly, "Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them." Not only are listeners still confused and still shocked by this, but if we keep reading the scripture, the next line states, when many of his disciples heard it, they said, "This teaching is difficult. Who can accept it? Who can accept it?" Some listeners are confused, some are shocked, and others are so horrified that they dismiss Jesus entirely. And who can blame them? I mean, the claim of eating the flesh and drinking the blood of someone enables you to have eternal life doesn't make literal sense. Perhaps you're thinking, oh, come on. We understand what that means for us today. But do we? Not only do we believe this, but we also believe that by the death on a cross, an act so horrific, that something good came of it. How can we accept this? How can we comprehend these things? It's hard. It's hard. It's because we'd rather dismiss these ideas as offensive and not part of what we believe. But let's just sit with them. Sit with them for a minute and consider. I don't believe Jesus is trying to gross us out. I don't believe Jesus is using shock tactics to gain followers. And I don't believe that Jesus is joking. What Jesus is trying to do is reveal exactly what his death on the cross means for us. God broke through our constrained human understanding by turning on its head crucifixion, something so horrible, into the ultimate act of love. Christ sacrificed himself for us to save our lives. The ultimate act of love. And if we hear only flesh and blood, then dismiss what Jesus is trying to teach, we don't truly understand the gift we've been given. Through Christ's death, we have all been redeemed. We've all received grace. And when if we dismiss what Jesus is trying to teach us, it means we also miss what it means to partake in Holy Eucharist. It would merely be an empty act, like receiving a holy happy meal only to find bread and wine without a surprise inside. And no meal is without God's surprise. Every meal comes with God's ultimate surprise, grace. All have received a new life, and not just a worldly one, but an eternal one. All have been given a life that is unearned and undeserved. We've all been given a love that accepts all and forgives all. A love that carries the weight of our sorrows, and a love that stays even when we turn away. A love that abides forever. And a love that stirs our hearts, enlightens our minds, and strengthens our wills. If we understand what Jesus' flesh and blood means to be the bread of life, we understand that we are sustained by this true food and drink. What do our lives look like? With this understanding, what does it look like to love God and love our neighbor? And whatever it looks like, whatever it looks like to you, I am assured that your soul, our souls, and all the souls that we come across will never be left empty. I speak to you in the name of one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.